Alright, so, good evening or morning or whatever time of the day it is, I don't care. Welcome to the first and, you know, hopefully not the last episode of Behind the Scenes with Solmon. I'm Solmon, your host, and today I'm joined by Commander-in-Chief of the Citrus Fruit. How you doing, Master of the Lemons?
I'm doing good. I'm happy to be on your show. It's an honor to be, you know, the focus of the first episode. So, you know, let's get into it.
Yes, especially after that fat paycheck I gave you.
well, we don't talk about that part.
Yes, especially since, you know, you don't want the audience knowing that you're, giving money here and there so that you get accepted on the TWR.
Yeah, you don't want them knowing about the bribes. That's probably not something we should make public.
I mean, that's kind of the thing with the Solmanic Empire, you know. We like bribing people, but we don't talk about it. So let me you know, get you in the mood, fellas. So basically, the idea of Behind the Scenes with Solmon is I go and, you know, kidnap your favorite content creators in the fandom, and I ask them the questions you're too afraid to ask. So, Master of the Lemons, I'm going to ask you something that everybody has been trying to ask you for centuries. Right?
Centuries, eh?
This question has been plaguing philosophers since the age of Plato. So, first question is, how the hell did you even, like, film with that Natford model? Like, in the Pacifics, for example, you're, like, the first, like, episode of your series.
So, do you mean Natford or Tidmouth?
Tidmouth, sorry.
Yeah, most people would probably look at it and think Natford because, you know, it's Big Station is really...
Yeah.
I really, just to simplify things, a lot of the time I just call it the Big Station because everybody knows what that is. And really, Natford in the TV series and Tidmouth in the Railway series, while they are radically different in design, functionally they're the exact same thing. And so that station was a pain to work with. I despised that thing.
Fun fact, you guys, Master of the Lemons and me are working on exposing the Tidmouth station model he made from, like, abusing him for, like, almost 2 years.
It was more like a handful
I'm
of months.
I'm pretty sure that can be classified as an abusive relationship.
It was, because here's the thing. The roof was ungodly heavy. It was made out of, like, one of those plastic floor mats that you, like, roll a desk chair around. Because my dad had one that he was throwing out. And so I thought, okay, I could use this. And so it had all of these little cracks in it, because, you know, it was old. In cracks in the roof. So it didn't bend well. And also, it was so thick that it was hard to carve that, to curve that shape, right? So it was constantly, you know, it kind of got that half-cylinder shape. That's how the canopies on Tidmouth are. But the problem was, it was so rigid that it wanted to go straight all the time. It wouldn't stay in a curve. And so, you know, I had to put these, like...
It was trying to break free.
Yes. And so I had to put these kind of green strings around it and tie it together so that it would keep it in position. But then it would buckle around the strings, so it wouldn't look very clean. But it worked. It served my purposes. So I built the whole main structure, that, you know, the actual buildings of the station out of cardboard, the platforms, the whole station. I think it's the only station I ever built where the platforms were permanently connected. Like, the whole thing was one piece. And it was like the first station I built. Because I built it for my HO series back before I decided to transition to wooden railway. So it was originally gonna hold.
Yes.
Yeah. So it was originally gonna hold
the prequels.
Yes. It was originally gonna hold HO engines, but luckily wooden railway was so close that I could just repurpose it without changing it at all. And so I basically made the whole structure out of cardboard, and then the plastic floor mat things I used, they weren't actually long enough to go to the end of the station. So what I did was I extended. I made, like, a kind of cardboard version of that at the very back that was gray. And I actually kind of liked the look of it. So I liked the station generally how it looked. I thought it was pretty neat. It was missing a lot of things that I would now put in it, like little shops and you know, like, just making it look more lively. And it didn't have the line to Ducks Branch line, which is a pretty big oversight. But other than that, I was pretty happy with it. But functionally, it was a nightmare because, like, the roof was so heavy, I maybe had 5 minutes until the thing collapsed in on itself. And when you have to film so much stuff at Tidmouth because it's a major location, it was a huge pain. So, you know, I got furious with the thing. I filmed it in the first three episodes. I used it for all of those, and each time I had to touch it up, had to retape certain parts, had to repaint over that tape so that I kind of touch it up. And I was furious with it. So by the time I had gotten to episode four, I was so angry with Tidmouth Station that I just threw the thing against the wall and just put it behind my table because there's this little gap between my filming table and the sky backdrop. And that's the gap that I walk through to access.
Lemmy, I'm sorry to interrupt you, but you're slowly starting to sound like the abuser in this story.
Well, yes, that is what happened. I became the abuser of this Tidmouth Station. Because
You guys heard it from him. I'm not spreading rumors. Dude, never mind behind the scenes with Solmon. This needs to be called therapy with Solmon. Some huge baggage you're dropping.
It is huge baggage. I am angry at this station.
I just wanted to make a show about fun facts about series, but no. You have to come here and ruin it with.
Well, you asked me the Tidmouth. Well, Solmon, you asked me the Tidmouth question, you know, so you're going to get the Tidmouth answers. And the Tidmouth answers are, I threw it on the ground, and then I trampled it for several weeks as I was working on Old Souls. I just walked over it every day. At first, I tried to step around it. I'm like, I'll probably need this again at some point.
But eventually,
I was just done with it. So by the time I basically just trashed the whole station. The only part I kept was the MC bomb.
Hello, FBI?
All right. It's in the past, Solomon. You don't need to call the police.
That's it. I'm calling the police, the FBI, the CIA, the KGB, the military. I'm bringing in the big guns because, dude, that's messed up. I mean, I've got frustrated with models before, but that's just messed up.
The thing is, next time I do Tidmouth, I'm gonna make it lighter. I'm gonna make the roof out of a thin plastic. It's all gonna be modular, so it's all gonna be in parts.
At least it has a good ending. You guys got back together. You're working on making it a healthier relationship.
The thing is, like, the Tidmouth was the first to go. I just threw out that station because I wasn't happy with the design. I knew that I would have to add Duck's branch line and all the other things like that. And so I was furious with it, so I basically just threw it away. But the other buildings I was all pretty happy with. However, recently I this will probably upset some people, but I threw away pretty much all the buildings for my series. Because I intend to rebuild it all, for my next videos. Because I have a lot of new design ideas and kind of new principles that I'm going to design by. And so I think that even the stuff I had already built, I'm going to rebuild because I could make it better. So it was kind of traumatic. Like, I needed space in my filming room. And I had all this stuff just in a pile.
It was a traumatic experience.
Because I don't treat my buildings well at all. I just throw them all in a heap, in a pile. And I fix them when I need them. And so, you know, they're in this big pile. And I literally
I used to think I mistreated my models. Like, I all put them in a shelf, like, neatly spaced together. And then I just see you, how you treat them, how you treat these works of art. That's like if I learned Da Vinci. To me, that's like hearing Da Vinci say, "Yeah, Mona Lisa, I just threw in the trash."
I think when you make models yourself, you don't value them as much as other people's stuff. Like, because you know you can make them again.
Yeah.
And that's kind of my situation. I did think about keeping some mementos. Like, I really thought about keeping Tidmouth Sheds, because that one did mean a lot to me, and maybe the bridge that Thomas, you know, collapses on. I decided, you know what, it would be sad to keep one thing and throw away all the others, so I just tossed everything. It's all gone. I kept the engines because they don't take much space, so I have all the engines I made and the figures and stuff I still have, but the buildings are all long gone. But I'll be building newer, better ones, pretty soon.
Yes, another question I have, which I feel not a lot of people are going to have, but something that has been, you know, troubling me since the day I was born. How and why are there parts for James on the island of Sodor, like in the episode?
So that's a very good question. So you're talking about episode four. Right? Yeah, you're talking about episode four, Old Souls. And so the reason... For those who don't know what happens... So spoilers for that episode, if anybody... I mean, it's years old at this point. Nobody cares. But if I'm about to spoil the episode.
Yeah, you idiots.
Basically what happens in that episode is that James has a serious accident and needs replacement parts. And then...
Yeah, basically he dies.
Yeah, and so then...
He gets murdered by Pip and Emma.
Yeah, and then Percy and... So then Percy and Edward basically are visited by some ghost engines from the Wellsworth and Suttery Railway. And one of those ghost engines leads them down the old Wellsworth and Suttery line, which is just Edward's line, but, like, there's a little branch that breaks off there at some point to go to the sheds. And so they push through the bushes and find the sheds of this old railway. And there are a lot of the parts of the original engines, you know, the four Wellsworth and Suttery engines that worked there. And so basically, the class, I don't know, it's like a Yates, Y-A-T-E-C-S, Yates 060. I've only ever been able to find one picture of this class, and I you know, we could even link it in the description if people want to see it, but basically, I found a very specific class that met the requirements of the Wellsworth and Suttery Railway. It was an 060, because we know that all four of those engines were 060s. We know that they were, I believe that the railway started in 1875. I'm not sure if that's correct or not, but it's like, it could be around there.
Dude, I barely know that, dude. Here's the thing, hold on. Sorry to interrupt, but that's the thing about, you know, being friends with Master of the Lemons. A railway that nobody knows about started, right? You could just ask him, hey, Lemmy, what happened on the 3rd of June 1943 at 6 o'clock at Wellsworth Station? And he would just give you an entire list of what happened. However, here I am. I can barely remember which day I was born in.
But yeah, so to answer your question, those engines, I went out of my way to meet three requirements. One, they had to be 060s, you know, tank engines. Two, they had to be, you know, built, you know, early as like 1870, like before 1875, I believe it was. Because I think that's when it could have been 1880, I'm not positive, but whenever the Wellsworth and Suttery started, they needed to be built before then so that they would make sense to be on the Wellsworth and Suttery from the start. And thirdly, and this is something that wasn't in people history and railways that I just made up for story purposes, they needed to be... from the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railway. And the reason for that was I wanted them to find these old engines and then the parts would be compatible with James. So that's total BS, right? Like not just because two engines were built by the same railway does not mean that their parts are going to work with each other, but narratively it felt right. Like, you know, okay, if we find these engines from the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railway, then they're going to be compatible.
Dude, what are you talking about? Hold on. Dude, what are you talking about? The other day, Ryan broke down, and they just went through Gordon's parts, and they just, you know, fixed them. That's how railways work, dude. That's
oh my
how
God.
Railways work. But yeah, ultimately, was just a narrative decision that kind of married into the entire story.
Exactly,
right?
Yeah. Because I basically, you know, I basically chose the Wellsworth and Suttery engines in that story because I thought that they would be a pretty cool, spooky old railway. And I wanted to tie them into James's thing at the beginning. And so the way I did that was by choosing a very specific class that met the description of the people, history, and railways, Wellsworth and Suttery engines, that was also from the Lancashire and Yorkshire Railway so that it overlapped with James. That's basically all that was. And so when those engines were scrapped, maybe they didn't use every part, and some of them were lying around. And when Edward and Percy go and find them, they happen to be the parts that James needs. So it's just a stroke of luck there. So narratively, I like how it feels, but it's not realistic at all. It doesn't make any sense there. Revisiting the Wellsworth and Suttery engines, eventually I'll probably change them up quite a bit. They'll probably not all be the same class because I feel like that's a little bit of a cop out. I feel like they should look a little bit different from each other. You know, I have some ideas for how I want to do them. You know, I'm not really happy with the idea.
Yeah, we need more diversity. Your series needs more diversity.
The thing is, like, I, you know, those...
We need more engine diversity. This is... Dude, it's 2019. We need more engine diversity.
I mean, kind of, though.
Come on.
The thing is, like, the Wellsworth and Suttery engines just, I don't like that I geared their whole design fully around, like, just their, you know, the fact that they needed to be compatible with James. Because those are a very important part of Sodor's history. I feel like they should be a more fleshed out cast of four characters that have their own unique designs and kind of, you know, I was using them as kind of a leg to stand on for that story. And I feel like they deserve more in-depth analysis and kind of, you know, creativity than that. So eventually I'm gonna reinvent them. But I am still pretty happy with the models that I made and everything. I think that they're pretty
neat. You're teasing the future, are you now?
Essentially, the thing is that the past and the present and the future are kind of intertwined to me, where it's like, it's, you know, when I think about my old work, I also think about where it's going, and I can't really talk about, like, say, Tidmouth without talking
basically
about its improvements.
Basically, you're just traveling through time in your head.
Yes, very much so. So what else have you got for me?
Yes. Now, another question I have... This time it's, you know, kind of more general, but what, but like, when I was watching Pacifics for the first time, when I was just a wee lad, I was a young child back then, when I was young and green. But yeah, I remember watching that episode and like, wow, like Spencer, he's a horrible engine. We all know that, and I hate him. But like... You made him a serial killer.
Yeah, I basically did. Yeah, the thing
and
is...
And hold on, that's not it. Normally you show us Spencer being a serial killer, but then the guy straight up gets freaking disowned by Gordon. He's just like left at London, and Gordon's like, yeah, good boy.
Yeah.
Like, screw you. Plus, something else that I don't really understand is Gordon says something along the lines of, I don't want you on my island anymore. Does this confirm that Gordon holds a lot? Does that mean that Gordon basically owns Sodor?
Is Gordon
part of the royal family?
There is honestly an interesting point to be made there where it's interesting that Gordon's angry at Spencer. And that actually does feed into him not coming back. Because the Fat Controller... I feel like the Fat Controller, upon realizing what Spencer's done and seeing how upset Gordon is... Like, he's not just being huffy. Gordon is legitimately devastated. So I feel like the Fat Controller would see that as an actual legitimate remark on Spencer's character. And would not bring him back for a long time. Because he would realize Spencer's done some awful stuff. But... The thing is, I originally intended to tie that up at the end of the year with another episode, because my fifth episode was originally going to be a Christmas episode, and it was gonna take place shortly after
Christmas never happens.
Yeah, it was gonna take place shortly after Old Souls. You know, where basically, you know, it was gonna tie up the Pacific storyline. It was going to have Spencer and Gordon reconcile and, you know, kind of, you know, get back together. And the thing is, it doesn't... I was really happy with the story. At the time, it was my favorite thing I'd ever written, and I still think it's a very good story. But I got involved in the Ultimate Christmas collab, and so I couldn't make it. You know, I simply didn't have the time, and I did the Special Funnel remake instead, which I'm very proud of it, but... On some level, I regret the collabs because my main passion is my series, and there's stories that will never get told now because I did the remake collabs instead. And that's why I haven't really... I've kind of sworn off collabs entirely.
This is the saddest thing to me.
Yeah.
This is the saddest thing to me.
I'm proud of the remakes I did, but, like, after New Friends for Thomas, I was kind of frustrated with it, and I'm like, I could have been making my original episode 4 idea, during that time, but I didn't. And then once I got to Ultimate Christmas, I was kind of on the fence. I'm like, do I want to join another one of these? But it looked really fun, and I'm like, okay, I'll join. And then after that, I was like, okay, I'm never doing a collab again. Because, like, I really wanted to do my Christmas episode.
This is like you, like, having... So, basically, imagine you, like, you know, going... You either have the choice of going to college or joining a gang. And you did the worst thing ever, and you joined the gang.
Well...
And now you're regretting not going to college.
You could make that comparison, sure. The thing is, it just, you know, I'm proud of what I did. I like the remakes I did, but after Ultimate Christmas, I was just like, never again. I am not getting involved in another big, like a big collaborative project where I can't work on my series.
Guys, please. If you ever see Lemmy, whether it be on Twitter, you know, any Twitter or like real life, please don't mention collab.
The thing is, I think one day,
flashbacks.
But here's the thing, Solomon, is that after that, I promised myself I would never do another big collaboration, and then I went and did JBS How It Should
and
Be.
And then you did.
Yeah, and that was 8 months, and that was really the point where I'm like, never again. I'm not ever doing that again.
And that's basically what you did is like, hey, I'm gonna go swim with sharks, and then you lost your leg. You're like, all right, I'll never do it again. Oh, look, a pool full of sharks. I'll do it again.
That's exactly what it is.
And then you just lose your other leg. And then you're like, eh, you know what, maybe I shouldn't do it. And now I'm just expecting the third act of your story. I don't know, maybe some new collab. And then you just do it, and then you lose half of your body. And then, yeah, I should probably do it anymore.
Yeah, it was really just,
guys, mark my words. This will be the reason why we'll never get the end of his series. You know why? Because he's slowly gonna do more and more collabs until gone are the days of Master of the Lemons, and now he's just Master of the Collabs.
I mean, you wouldn't be wrong to think that, considering my track history here, track record. But you know, it really and the thing about JBS is that I would not have, I was definite after Ultimate Christmas, I'm not doing another collab. But then when JBS happened, it wasn't really for the same reasons. It wasn't just like a fun project. It was a miserable thing to work on.
Basically, you guys were just going to war.
Yeah, it was like that. I mean, it was essentially that we were frustrated, mainly I was frustrated, that, people didn't seem to share my views on the current show, and so I made a whole movie to kind of give people my idea of it. And you know, that's not a good reason to make. I don't think that's a very good reason to make
That's like if a movie director just saw a bad movie and was like, you know what, I'll goddamn remake this, and I'll make it 10 times better with 10 times less the budget.
The thing is, it's like I at this point I'm not really happy with JBS anymore because we just did so many things.
It's a good film. Honestly, for what it is, it's a good film.
Well, thank you.
But I feel like the biggest problem with GBS, how it should be, is just the reason you, like, the way you present it and the way you sold the idea.
That's the thing. And the problem there, Solomon, is that's the only reason it exists. Everyone looks at it and says, oh, well, if you just change the name, it wouldn't be as offensive. And that's the problem. It was meant to be offensive. The whole thing was designed because we were frustrated that people didn't agree with us.
Yeah,
and so we made a whole movie.
You guys offended Mattel. Oh, man, that's so rude.
Yeah.
You guys are so rude. You offended a multi-million dollar company.
Solomon, we also offended.
Come on.
We also offended.
The giant corporation has feelings.
But we also offended other fans who enjoy the current show, right? It's no different from saying, oh, well, Thomas, you know, you shouldn't like Thomas because it's not for you. It's no different saying, oh, you shouldn't like The Bouncing or you shouldn't like Big World Big Adventures. You have no right to tell people what they should and shouldn't like.
And sadly, Lemmy, I'm sorry to inform you guys, but sadly, we've run out of time. And you know what, Lemmy? This was a bang old time.
Yeah, no, this was a lot of fun. I mean, I think we hit a lot of interesting points. I asked some interesting questions.
You know, just to make sure, I think I might edit out that part about the Tim station. You know, We don't want you to be on some sort of government list.
Yeah, if you leave that in, I'll probably be in some serious trouble. I mean, I treated that tin myth is not, it's not family friendly
It's really inhumane. You'll have stations against you.
Yeah, there's going to be a big station protest, and I'm going to get sued by a few people. Yes,
guys, this was your fabulous and quite frankly handsome host, Solmon. And we're checking out. Say goodbye, Lemmy.
Goodbye, and thank you for having me on. It's been a lot of fun.
All right, goodbye.